Thank you very much, Lori. And thanks to the entire staff of the Southampton Historical Museum for welcoming us and for their interest in collaborating on oral history and for providing a wonderful venue for these activities to happen in. Our Rogers Memorial Library's oral history collection will eventually be housed here as well as at the library. So we really welcome and invite you to come and learn more about what we've been doing over the years when you have time. And thanks to our own staff for being here in various capacities so that you'll be able to tell your friends they can catch this event on the library's website at some point, because part one is already on our website, and we'll tell you how to do that later if you want. But we're really delighted about it. Yeah, as most of you know, because I think most of you remember Southampton in the earlier years, except for we have some young ones over there. But in the 30s and 40s, the villages of Watermill and Southampton looked very different from how they look today. One of the biggest differences was that there were so many working farms. There were over a half a dozen dairy farms alone, many of them located right in the village limits of Southampton. Watermill was a particularly sleepy community, I mean, except for the farmers. The Villa Maria, as you remember, was an active place. And if you drove through Watermill, chances are you might see one of the nuns crossing the street. That was a memory a lot of people have. There was a little IGA, and we'll hear a little bit more about Watermill from Pat Rischel, who was there to remember it all. There were fewer but larger families, by and large, and most of them were one-vehicle families. The village was remarkably shopper-friendly, with two pharmacies, two hardware stores, two stationery stores, plus a newspaper store, two five-and-dimes, four grocery stores, and a butcher. So it was a great place to shop back then. There were several restaurants to choose from, the Hampton Manor, Balzerini's, Caledima's, John Duck's, Herb McCarthy's, and the Windmill, which was in Watermill as a tea room. The Windmill. There was a Watermill tea room. We can talk about that later. There was Anne's Luncheonette. Remember where that was, where Barristers is now? And across the street was Margaret's Rendezvous. Remember Margaret's with great pies? She had great pies. And there was Crutchley's Crullers, which many of you remember. It was not uncommon to know many, if not most, of the people you would typically run into from Labor Day to Memorial Day, or even July 4th, which really was more or less the start of the summer season. And then the season did end promptly after Labor Day. So today, with the help of our three wonderful guests, we'll hear a little bit about what it was like to grow up in this community before it became known as the Hamptons. And we're grateful to these three, and I'd like to introduce them to you. Seated next to me is Sarah Thomas, known to many of you as a great cookie baker and other things. After graduation from Southampton High School, Sarah did some work locally, babysitting and cleaning, and then she attended Cornell, where she studied home economics. After her graduation, she went to Philadelphia to take a job teaching. At the same time, she worked toward and earned a master's degree in home economics at Drexel University. Sarah taught home economics in Philadelphia from 1951 to 1985, when she retired. Active in her church, which is the King's Chapel Church of God in Christ with Pastor Frank White, she has been a member for many years. She was also active in her Home Economics Association for many years. Sarah is an active member of the Chamber of Commerce. She sells Avon products, and she has a B&B on Pelham Street. Once a month, She's a member of a group that meets once a month called the Lunch Bunch, which includes, among other people, Pat Rischel, Hortense Gordon, who's not here today, Helen Vinsky, Marie Macari, Judy Johnson, and Donnie Brown. So it's a great pleasure to have Sarah Thomas with us today. Please welcome Sarah Thomas. Pat Rischel is next to Sarah. Pat was born in Southampton Hospital. Is it okay if I say the date? She was born in Southampton Hospital on October 30th, 1929. She attended it in her very early years. She, as you know, if you came last time, she attended a school in Louisiana. And then she came back to Southampton and graduated in 1947. And then attended Ithaca College of Music as a flute major, where she met her husband Earl, who's just walked in the door.
Good.
She got a master's in elementary education and taught first and third grades for 15 years in Broad Auburn, New York, taking a few years off to have children. Earl, her husband, as many of you know, was a longtime music teacher in Southampton, but before that he taught in Broad Lawn. He became the director of music in Southampton High School, and so they're well known as a music-loving couple. Pat and Earl are the parents of three children, Debbie, Jeff, and Matthew, and the grandparents of five children. Pat has been active for many years in her church and sings in the church choir. It's a pleasure to have Pat with us today. Please welcome. And to your left is wearing this sporty hat is Roxanne Dozier, whose husband Joe, hello Joe, just came in the door as well. Roxanne was in the class of 1946. So she was 1 year ahead of the other two. She attended Southampton schools, then did domestic work for a number of local families. She was a Wingfield, by the way, and that's a name that many of you will have heard of. Before she married Joseph Dozier, she had her first child in 1954. Is that Michael?
Yes.
Who's living in Atlanta, Georgia. We wish that her kids were able to be here, but her second child, Deborah, is in Orlando, Florida, getting her master's at this time. And her third child, Karen, is in Chesapeake, Virginia, and she works for the state of Virginia. So she's got great kids scattered here and there. Roxanne is known to many people for having worked 24 years in the Southampton school system as a teacher's assistant and a teacher's aide. So she did a lot of time in the schools here. She's been active in the First Baptist Church since the age of five, and she still sings in the choir. Roxanne began teaching Sunday school when she was 16, and apart from a six-month trip to South Carolina, where she briefly considered living and then changed her mind and came back, she taught until she was 75. So from age 16 to 75, she was teaching Sunday school. That's a huge number of years, and did a lot of teaching and influenced a lot of kids, I'm sure. Mostly, she enjoys spending time with her large extended family, and we're very, very grateful to Roxanne for being here today. Please welcome Roxanne. So, the last time we met, we spoke kind of extensively of people's families and their backgrounds. We'll do a very quick summary of where people's families were from, but not where they lived at various different years. But can we start with Roxanne, with you, and how your family arrived in Southampton?
Good morning to everyone. My family arrived from Virginia in 1927. Elm Street where I think the name is Sylvania's. Now, they stayed there just a short while and eventually got a job on the farm on North Main Street with Samuel Newberry, where I stayed until I was about 16. And then my dad built a home on Hillcrest Avenue, and we moved to Hillcrest Avenue, where I'm still there, next door to where I grew up in my teenage days. My husband built, and I built a home there next door to, we had property that my parents left us, and we built next door, and we enjoyed being there. And
so you've been part of that community for a long time. Yeah.
Yes.
Well, good. So we can place you in context a little bit, Roxanne. Thanks. Pat, how about you?
Well, I was born in Southampton Hospital, same year as Jackie Kennedy.
We didn't share the room.
Do you think they switched the cribs, maybe?
And during the Depression, my father went with other people to survey the Mississippi, so we lived in first New Orleans for a year, and then Morgan City. So I had a southern accent. And then we moved back to Watermill and lived until I went to school, to college, in the homestead, which Ray Sockleben had done there. And
which was on the piano.
It was always a two-family house. My Aunt Ida and Uncle Denton lived in one half, and we lived in the other. And then Uncle Denton and Aunt Elsie lived in one half, and we still lived in the other. And then my grandma lived in one half, and we lived in the other. And then Carol Sockleben's Aunt Emily and Uncle Carlos lived in this half with their five children. We still lived in the other. And it was a wonderful way of growing up to be with family, especially my grandma, because I could go down the stairs and there was her bedroom. She would share so much.
It's a nice opportunity that so many people do not have
right
today.
Yeah. It was wonderful.
Thank you. How about you, Sarah?
I was born here in Southampton on the third floor, too. And my parents came here from Virginia. They came up here to work, and they stayed, you know. And it so happens that my father's mother, and Roxanne's mother, were sisters. So we're cousins.
Yes.
And we just visited family. We were on at first we were on Halsey Avenue. Then we moved to North Sea Road, and my father finally got a house on Pelham Street, which is up off Moses Lane. But we've been here. We're what you call really locals.
Really locals.
And
the area in Virginia that so many people came from. Where was that? Was it Dinwiddie? That's a name that kind of crops up. And where is that in Virginia?
Not far from Petersburg. Not too far.
Okay.
Petersburg was the largest city.
Yeah.
Okay.
Development.
But people kept their ties there and sort of visit.
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. You talked a little bit about your homes. I remember one thing that is different from today is that most of the houses didn't have central heat. None of them did, as far as I remember from what you told us. Pretty much all of you grew a certain amount of your food. Is that correct? Roxanne's father had a smokehouse.
Yes.
And that was kind of an active place. Want to just say a couple of words about that, Roxanne?
The smokehouse was just I would say it's 2x4, but it was bigger than that. And when they kill the hogs, my father would take certain portions of the meat that was smoked, in particular a ham and the shoulder. to speak, and build a fire in that little house. And when he lit the fire, you could see, when he put the meat in there, you could see the smoke seeping out through the cracks all over the place. But it was a good thing because we had, we could go down and get a ham in the middle of January, February, have a nice ham.
But what kind of wood did he use in what kind of stove?
I don't actually know what kind of stove it was,
okay.
But it was a type of wood or whatever they had that would produce, that it would like be smothered down,
okay. Mm-hmm.
That it wouldn't come up in the flame, but it would the heat from the smoke would cure the meat.
How long would it take to cure?
I'm not too sure. Maybe someone else here may know about how long. I know my husband would know. But it would take, I guess, a whole day to cure a piece of meat,
okay.
Like that. It would have to stay in that heated,
yeah.
Smoke for a long, long time to cure.
When they say smoke cured, is that what they,
yeah.
Mean by smoke?
Yes.
And was it typical for people to have did many people have a smokehouse that you knew of?
I don't know that too many people had it, but I think the ones who had them shared them,
okay.
With friends and neighbors.
So people could bring their own
yes.
Pieces of
meat. Yes.
And then after the meat was smoked and you stored it, where did you store it? In the cellar?
We stored it in the basement, yes, and we had a basement, full basement down there.
And what other kinds of things did you all store in your cellars?
Yes, we do a lot of canning. My mom did a lot of canned vegetables and fruit and what have you. And we would just store it and then we'd just run down the basement and get whatever we needed.
Can't remember anything except the coal shuttle and the coal.
Yes.
I don't think
right.
We used our basement
right.
For much other than
right.
That.
Speaking of food and food memories, I know that you all talked a little bit about your memories of things that you particularly loved and meals that, like, your father's cooked in a couple of cases, your grandmother's potato pancakes.
Hash browns.
Hash
coming
browns.
Down cellar, or coming down the stairs, going to her kitchen, Joy smelled so good, the hash browns and whatever else she was cooking.
Mm-hmm.
And then my father, I think I mentioned that, one of my best memories was my father, every Saturday night, would make pancakes. And he would make them in the shape of bunny rabbits. And I just, you know, it's one of the most treasured memories that I have.
Right.
From such a little thing.
Right.
So important.
And sweet potatoes.
Sweet potato pie.
Sweet potato pie. Sweet potatoes when you came home from school.
Oh, yeah. They were on the stove. They had been baking in the oven, and then you come home from school, and they would be lined up sweet potatoes. All baked.
Needless to say, I'm sure most of your food was homemade.
It was. It was.
Did you have biscuits or cornbread or?
Yes, all the time. We had that all the time, and of course we had the sandwiches for school. We had, you know, loaf bread, but otherwise, biscuits, cornbread, and rolls.
And rolls.
My mother was a favorite with rolls.
Yes.
All the children,
yeah.
Youngsters from the church on Sunday would come over, and they know that my mom made rolls on Sunday. And not only the children, the men would say to my dad, who was deacon on the deacon board, and they would come and they'd get a taste of the rolls. And every time I looked around, they were there. We're back again this Sunday. Yes, we come for rolls. And enjoy this.
I mean, hot bread is just not something that most people would get,
right.
Like
right.
The way you got it, you know, bread or cornbread or whatever it was. What about you, Sarah? What were your favorite foods?
Well, we had a lot of chicken because we raised chickens.
Mm-hmm.
And fact, one time I said, if we have any more chicken, I'll get a feather. But we used to kill the chickens right there yard and...
Did you do that? Did you participate?
No, I didn't. I just watched. Father did that. Yeah. And then we have hot rolls too. And Superdick Pine.
Beach Plum Jam?
Beach Plum Jam, yes. We have to go pick them. Can't find them too much now. But we would go along the beach, we'd go along the road and pick them. And my mother would make beach plum jam. It was good. It has a nice tart.
Yep. What about shellfish or fish? Did you go clamming or did you get shellfish or fish for meals very often?
Yes, my mom would go fishing. There's a little pond down near Watermelon, between Watermelon and the camping area. She'd go all the time. And she would catch fish, and we'd have fresh fish at least once per week.
Really?
Right from the water. And very good.
Okay.
We had a fish, it wasn't a fish monger.
Fish man? Mr. Rayner?
Probably. He would come once a week.
With his green truck?
With his green truck. Good memory. And so we had fish once a week.
Yeah, I remember this time of year, it would be this time. My father would say, well, the LYs are running, so all the men would go down and get fish.
They used to do that in North Sea, is that?
Yeah,
that
North Sea. North Sea.
Did they really wiggle when they were in the fried pan, or was that
something? No. It was an eel.
Oh, eels.
Oh, God.
That was an eel.
It's not a good picture.
Was the mill in Watermill working back then as a mill?
No, I don't believe it was. Okay. Not that I remember. But
so you had to buy your flowers and all that kind of stuff. And where did you shop? Let's start with you, Roxanne. I mean, you obviously had a certain amount you grew and fended for yourself there.
Yes.
But where did you do most of your shopping for the staples that you needed?
Well, I guess my dad did most of the shopping, and I guess it was in P.
Okay. On Hampton Road.
Yes. And then there was a little deli store. I think it was Mr. Gardner.
Yes.
Okay.
And
was that on Job's Lane?
No.
That was on Hampton Road. Okay.
And in fact, his son was in nine class in school.
Okay.
Yes. And my dad would go there. He was real lenient with my dad because, you know, he had such a large family.
Mm-hmm.
And things that maybe that was still good, fruit or what have you, that he could not put back
mm-hmm.
on the market
right.
the next day, he would, you know, let my father have
okay.
a lot like that because of the family that
That's
we
nice.
Had. And but we had plenty. We had plenty.
You had plenty.
We always had plenty. Mm-hmm. We were never hungry.
Yep. How about you, Pat? Where did your family...
Well, I think probably in Southampton at the APA. I remember going with my father during the war, the rationing, you know, thing.
Yeah.
But Watermill was quite different. I asked Paul Corwith about the stores in Watermill because I couldn't remember them all. And there was
yeah.
Ralston's that we did shop
was in. Was that in Watermill?
That was
oh,
in
yes.
Hayes Mercer was
yeah.
the proprietor. And then Bailey Schultz had a hardware store in Watermill. And Henry and Kate Parr's, of course, that was like a sort of, like the penny candy sort of.
So these were all along
all the
what is now
absolutely.
The main.
It was
wow.
a thriving little community. And I hadn't finished. There was a barber shop. It was John's Barber Shop. I had right these Jose's Plumbing. We graduated with Jerry
yeah.
Jose, which is plumbing. And then, of course, the post office, which was wonderful. So,
yeah.
And yeah, it was wonderful. Then across the street, of course, was the windmill,
mm-hmm.
and
the Villa Maria. Did you ever go to the Villa Maria when you were a kid? I mean,
well, I just remember this was on Christmas time. They would, I think, decorate the tree that was in the green, and at that point, there were novices. They're studying to be nuns,
oh, okay.
and you know, young people, and they were all dressed, and they would come walking with candles, and singing.
Really?
I'll never forget that. I don't know know how many years ago it was, but. And then later it became
a sort of retirement community center, right?
Yes, yeah. And it was, they had an open house there, not an open house, a designer showcase, and I remember working there, this was a few years ago, and there was ladies, nuns, that had come back to see, and she said, this is where we had our arithmetic. And then we go to another room, and this is where we studied science. And they were so excited to come back to their school, because it was a school, and then it was a retirement place for the nuns to retire.
Pat, did you know anybody who went to the Hayground School?
No.
Oh, no, the Hayground people went, you know, but obviously you weren't in Hayground.
No.
So, okay. Sarah, what about you and your family and where they shopped for food?
Oh, we shopped here in Southampton at the AMP, and it was a Bohacks.
On Main Street.
Right on the corner.
Yes. And then we got things from the farm, but it was right here, right here in Southampton.
Yeah. And then the Bohacks moved to where the CVS is now.
Yeah.
Remember?
I think so.
Yeah. But before that, the Hampton Manor was there.
Mm-hmm.
Do you remember that? Any of you?
Yes, my
the Hampton Manor?
Mom used to work there.
She did?
Mm-hmm.
Did you ever go there to
see
your mom or any place? I mean, I've talked to an occasional person who went there for a meal,
mm-hmm.
but I think most people just didn't go out very much. Did they?
I think it was there that one of my friends was married and had the reception at the Hampton Manor.
Yeah.
It was very nice.
Yes.
And now the Hampton Manor, the building that was the Hampton Manor, is still got moved to Hampton Road and is now some condominiums on Hampton Road. Part of it.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Uh-huh. And I think it may even be called the Hampton Manor or something like that. Yeah. Even during the Depression years, I take it, do you all remember when the stock market crashed? No, you were too young.
Well, it was the day before I was born.
Yeah, okay. Well, that's right. I'm sorry, Sarah.
I do remember my Uncle Monty lost all his money.
Okay.
Everything. So.
Sorry about that. I've talked to certain people who said that the Depression was sort of in Southampton, that most people had enough to eat, but that it really lasted almost until the hurricane of 38, effectively, even though, yes, obviously you wouldn't remember, but before the hurricane, in that decade when you were 4, 5, 6, 7, did you remember people struggling or, I mean, obviously probably no one had a lot except for the people who visited in the summer, but did you ever feel that you had to go without things? That other people had, or
before my father went down, we went down south. I remember he was home, and we did a jigsaw puzzles. And I thought, this is wonderful fun. You know, my father's there, and we're having time together. So, that little bit of was sort of a happy time.
I think in all the interviews that we've done, I don't think we've come across people who remembered the kind of Depression years as a really bad time, you know, per se. To get back to the village a little bit, I think that we talked a little bit about movie theaters, which weren't a big part of your lives. The stores we talked about, the shoe stores, Hildegard and Eric Peters, Hildreth's, some of the Five and Dimes. Was Hildreth's a place that your families went for a lot of things?
Yes, we did.
Now sewing was something that you all did. In fact, if you look in back of us, you'll see two aprons. You want to just tell us about the aprons?
Oh, I don't have much to say about them. It's like my mother's apron.
Yeah, it's a homemade apron. It looks like
beautiful.
It was made yesterday.
Yeah.
It's
yeah.
Beautiful shape.
And,
would she have gotten a pattern at Hildreth's to make that apron?
That's right.
Which apron? The green one?
Green one was passed.
But
oh, okay.
mother didn't make it. My mother didn't. So
okay.
The only thing, and I couldn't find the darning aid that they call it, or bra. The only thing she did was darn the socks.
Yes.
And everybody did that, didn't they?
Yeah. Yeah. They had to.
Yes.
And the other apron, the purple apron.
That was my mother's.
That was your mother's.
Beautiful.
But people talked about going to Hilda's to get patterns.
Yes.
Just everyone sewed, didn't they?
Yes. Yes, I sewed. My mom sewed. My mom could take a yard of material from Hilda's, 25 cents a yard, and make a dress for school or for us. You know, she would make things for school.
Well, that was my husband's mother. He had three big sisters, three older sisters, and she would walk them down to the department store in Mechanicville, and they would pick out the dress that they wanted, and she would come home
and just sew,
it without a pattern.
Awesome.
Yeah,
that was everyone sewed, didn't they? Everyone sewed. My mother sewed, and she made us all dresses that all looked alike. Because, you know, it was just easier.
Yeah. Yeah.
But we had so few dresses that we had one thing that we called our movie skirts, because we went to the movies once.
Oh.
You know what I mean? We just associated each item of clothing with an event, because we didn't have that many. We just didn't have that many clothes.
Sure.
We didn't buy them, usually. Did any of you remember house calls that doctors made? Mm-hmm. Or?
Yes, I remember I was running to meet my father. He was coming from work one day, and I tripped over a bag of trash or something, and there was glass in there, and the glass cut my artery here, thing. And my mom grabbed that diaper that my little sister was looking at, and tied a tourniquet around to stop it. And I remember, never forget, Dr. Skank, was it?
Yeah.
He came, and he said, "Hey, poor and but that kept the infection away, and you know,
you were.
I was okay.
Lived to tell the tale.
I lived to tell the tale.
The hospital was quite different, wasn't it?
Yes.
Do you remember the old hospital before they did all the additions and so forth? There's some people who.
But did I tell my story about getting my tonsils out?
Oh, tell me.
Well, it's not terribly exciting. The only thing I remember, I had a little green suitcase, and my mother and father walked me to the door of the hospital, and I guess they kissed me goodbye. Then I had to go through that whole experience, which I don't remember as being bad, but I thought, why aren't my parents with me? Oh, I had a little, probably third grade, maybe. I was young, you know, I needed my parents. I think that was a rule.
Probably.
That's my memory.
Okay, schools. The schools that you went to. I know you talked a little bit about some of the teachers. Why don't you mention a few of them? Let's talk about Miss Schrader, because she's someone that a lot of people would remember. Who had Miss Schrader? You had it. Okay. Roxanne, what do you remember about her? Describe her.
Miss Schrader, I'm sure that most of the people here know. I'm not sure of that, but
she was tall.
Very, very tall.
She was
tall, very tall.
Yes, she was.
Actually, her nickname was Stretch.
She was about 6, you know, she was over 6'5".
Yes, she was tall.
Yes.
She was really tall.
And I, you know, I got along well with her. She was a nice teacher.
Yes.
She was a good teacher, nice teacher. But I had a problem in conjugating. I could not conjugate to save my life.
She was a Latin teacher.
Yeah.
And she would keep me after school to you know, to help me out, which, you know, I really appreciated that. Mm-hmm. But I missed my bus, and I had to walk to North Main Street, North Main Street to get home. But I liked her very, very much, and the children, they always, you know, because she was so tall and lanky, so to speak, they would, you know, they always, you know, would pick at her. They loved her, but they would always have, you know, they'd always have laughs. And I remember sitting in class, and I could not hold my laugh. And she would say, "Now, class, I don't want you to even smile. I'd have to put my head down in my desk somewhere." And we had one young dog from Watermill, name was Robert Stewart. He and his sister both were in the same class. And he was just like the class cut up. He would do something funny every day. And she would, "Now, Robert, you know that isn't right." He says, "Well, Miss Schrader, if it wasn't so, I just learned in church yesterday, the pastor told me, if it wasn't so, I would not have told you." That's my words. "Well, Robert, I just don't believe it." And then the class would just, they would just go to pieces. We couldn't help her. No matter what she said to him, she had a word back for the teacher, which would get everybody just in stitches. I remembered her, but I really liked her.
Yeah, she was a pretty beloved teacher.
She was good.
How about you, Pat? Did you have Ms. Schrader?
Yeah, I brought my, we had a 50th reunion, and there are some favorite memories. They're all anonymous. No one knows who said it, but I had Ms. Schrader, and if you didn't get at least a 98 on your Regents, you were in trouble. She was perfection. Mm-hmm. And I remember our group of us went to sing Christmas carols to her. Mm-hmm. And we sang Adeste Fidelis in Latin, of course. Lise LaFon was the soloist. And I just, can I just read a few things?
Yeah, please do.
Some of them I won't read because we wouldn't believe this class of 47 could have a memory of this. This is when Marjorie Blythe expelled me, this is anonymous, it wasn't me, from her class for the remainder of the year because I refused to write isosceles 2,000 times. The first time she spoke to me after that was to fuss because I missed one question on the Regents exam and only got 98. The day when my cousins, I won't say who they are, brought birds to school in a brown paper bag. They let them loose during study hall, which we thought was hilarious. Marge Blythe didn't think it was funny at all. Here's another. At the time, it wasn't my favorite memory. Marilyn Smith and I were caught by Miss Schrader when we were trying on her famous tricorn hat. Many extra pages of Latin were translated that night. And there's a few others. Going to Mr. Casti's history classes, to this day I still read history books. You had something nice to say about Mr. Casti. He was just wonderful.
He was.
Walking with my class into assembly to the strains of Stars and Stripes Forever. Listening to Miss Blythe, every morning we would have a Bible passage. And did we pray too?
I'm not sure.
Bibles. Listening to Miss Blythe read from the Bible, her favorite passage began, "Though I speak with the tongues of men and angels and have not charity." And that was a nice way to start the morning.
You wouldn't hear it today, but...
No, I think about that a lot.
Yeah.
And the last one I have here is watching Boss Lillywhite conduct the band and the orchestra, because he was another very important teacher in our lives.
Miss Monahan in fifth grade and sixth grade. Yes. Very good math teacher, strict. And everybody was scared of her because she failed. She would always keep me after school to get my math problems right, which was a good thing. But I would cry because if I didn't get home at a certain time, I would be punished at home. I knew so. I had to be home at a certain time. So finally, it was teacher night, and she finally explained to my mom and dad why I was kept after school, because I had to get my math right. And in the end, I passed math, and I was good.
It sounds as though you were all very diligent, and there was a lot of expectation that you would practice and do things right.
From home and teachers.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Was Latin something that many people studied back then? Because certainly today it's... What about languages? French? Spanish?
Miss Lee taught Spanish and French.
Did they have school lunches back then, or did you bring your lunches, or go home for lunch?
I guess we brought our lunch.
Yeah,
lunch room in the grade school.
Well, but you couldn't buy lunch there. In other words, you brought your own lunch.
Yes.
Okay.
Not then. I don't know what year we started.
Later they started.
Mr. Cassidy was someone who many people remembered, just by way of mentioning good teachers who...
Yes.
And you believed every word he said. I don't know that that was good or bad, but I mean, no, he was very intelligent. I didn't mean it that way, but we just took for granted what Mr. Cassidy had to say was right, and probably always was. He was remarkable.
He was remarkable.
Left an impression.
Mr. Cassidy lived near me on North Main Street. And one summer, my youngest daughter, she had a little problem with history.
Mm-hmm.
And he was good enough to invite her down to his house at least two or three afternoons a week. And he'd take out in the backyard, on the back porch, and he would go over the history, you know, that she needed, that she'd veil, and he wouldn't ask not one penny. He wouldn't take a dime.
Isn't that nice?
He was very, very nice to us.
He was still teaching when I was in school, and people loved him.
Yes. In fact, I went to the three schools, through the three schools in Southampton, and so did three of my children. Went from kindergarten through graduating in Southampton. And then I worked 23 years in the elementary school, and 3 years in summer school, and in the high school.
You should point out what the school, where the schools were, for a few people who may not know. The elementary school was
where it is now. The high school.
The stairway still looks the same as when we had a little change. I pay my taxes when the study hall used to be. It didn't study hall look big. Now it doesn't, but nice.
Let's talk about something we didn't spend any time on, and that's the hurricane of 1938, because I think you all have memories of that. But can we start with Roxanne and just get a sense of how the day was for you, how it started out, what your awareness was, if anything?
Well, the day started out, I didn't have an inkling. It was a cloudy day. I didn't have an inkling that we were going to have a storm of the sort that, because we had never been through anything like that. So we went to school and we had lunch, I recall. I was fifth grade, Mr. Hyde's class. And the wind started so terrific. The wind was so strong. And I sat near the window in the classroom that I could look out to see the high school, school and the high school. And I looked out and I could see slate just coming off the roof of the high school, blowing from the east toward the elementary school. And I looked out and there was a young lady coming, walking. Now whether she was coming to the elementary school or whether she was going home, going through down to Cameron Street or that direction, I don't know.
Yeah.
But the wind was blowing so terrific, and as I looked out, and the teacher tried to keep us sitting, and I just happened to look out and peek out, and I saw this lady coming, and I was just so frightened for her, and because the slate was coming down near by the tennis court toward the elementary school, and I heard that one girl got killed by the slate, And I'm hoping and praying that it wasn't the lady that I saw.
Right.
It could have been,
right,
but I'm not sure of that. But however, we finally got, the buses ran a short while, but when the wind got
Did they let school out early or no?
No, the wind just came all of a sudden, so suddenly it just came up so rough that and we were, you know, just placed in our classrooms to sit and wait. I understand that some of the buses took the early students, mm-hmm, but by the time it got around to my area, the buses, they put an end to the bus. Mm-hmm. But my bus driver, and I don't know, I wish I could find his family, his daughters or grands or something, lived in Watermill. His name was Foster, and we called him Scrubby. Scrubby Foster. And he was good enough to come to my classroom to tell me, I'll take you home, to tell my teacher, I'll take her home.
Right.
Go get your sisters. I had two other sisters. I was fifth. My sister Alice was... Alice was third and Louise was first.
Okay.
So the three of us was in the elementary.
Okay.
So he got us all together and he took us, put us in his car, and we traveled around, and we had to travel around. We lived North Main, of course. But he had to be careful because there were so many fallen wires across the street.
Right.
But he didn't have too many places to detour,
right,
because there was no, you know, could get to the home nothing other than go around. So I think that's what we had to do.
Right.
Go around,
right,
the North Main and come down to my street drive where Mr. Cassidy was living.
Okay.
And we got home, we had to, and we lived near the water company where all the pine trees are.
Mm-hmm.
So he had to take us one by one. Of course, I was the oldest, so I had to wait till last. But he was so good to us. He took us one by one under one arm. We both had to crawl on the ground. My house was, the driveway was from here to into this room over there,
mm-hmm,
and was distant from the road.
Right.
But I sat in the car and shaking and trembling for a while, and he took us one by one under his arm, close to the pine trees, which was close to our house, and the east wind was just blowing in our faces, so we couldn't, you know, stand up so high. So we had to crawl, and my mother was at the front door, because the front door was on this side, not the east, but on toward the west. But then when I got in the house, I looked up, and the wires that, where the Highway 39S is running now, there were high tension wires over there, those with wires. And I looked out the window, and I saw humongous big black balls, like big black balls of soot, traveling those wires.
Wow.
And it got to a certain point, and it would explode into flames.
Oh,
I was nervous. I was so nervous. I was shaking. But, and then my dad worked in the barn, maybe as far as from here, maybe to that next, a little further than that building over there. And he had to get, was an apple orchard in between our house and the barn, and we see him coming to the ground with a crowbar. He had to stay on the ground with a crowbar to wake him down, keep the wind from blowing him away. And
your mother must have been relieved to see you.
Yes, she was. She was.
And when you were in your house, did you feel safe in your house?
Well, I did after I got there. I said I could look and see all the things bursting into flame and everything. And I when I walked in the house, I said to my mother, I had two younger ones home, my sister and my younger brother. And I said, where are the children? Where's my sister and brother? She says, look, there they are. And my sister peeked out from under the bed. She says, here I am giving you my blanket and I'm going to spend the night here. She didn't really spend the night there, but she was so nervous because she was just about, you know, 4 years old.
Sure.
She wasn't in school
so
yet.
So nothing, you had never experienced anything like this?
No lights, but we had heat because we had wooden coal stove and a little heater, because we kept warm. But it was some experience that I never really want to witness.
I agree. That's
a lot of memories from that.
Yeah. Pat, how about you and your experience of that day in September, whatever?
I can't top yours. That was Scrubby Foster was a hero.
Yes.
Really?
I just remember I must have been in fourth grade, and I just remember standing at the window watching the library roof blow off, and we're all in line, and I'm crying. And the teacher said, "Why are you crying?" And I said, "I'm going to miss my bus." I guess I didn't, but the bus is Uncle Len, Dar's Uncle Len. He was the one that came and took us home. And I know we're going over the bridge in Watermill, and we couldn't go. We had to turn around. But he got us home, and I don't really know how. And I remember when we were home, we had a great big, to me it was a huge pine tree in the front lawn, and it fell. And then I guess the eye came and all was quiet, and then the storm came again, and it just took that tree and turned it around. And then the next day, I do remember, we must have had permission to go down to the beach, because the devastation, I'll never forget. The grand pianos on the beach, and I mean, that sticks in my mind even more than the hurricane, what I saw the next day down in the ocean. So,
did they have school the next day?
No.
Was it days before they had school?
No, I think it was days before we got school.
Yeah, with all the damage. Yeah.
No electricity.
Yeah. And the thing is, no one knew the hurricane was coming.
That's right.
It was just, they thought it was just going to be a northeastern.
Oh, right.
Yeah, I was in school too. We were different class though.
Yeah, but we're in the same.
And I saw the wind and the rain coming down in sheets. I said, "Oh my God!" And I saw a couple of trees topple over. I said, "Oh!" And when it rains, my father would usually come pick us home. He would take us home, mm-hmm. pick us up. Also, my father, he's in Watermill. He won't be able to come pick us up. So I'll never forget Mary Lee Jefferson. She was there with her children. She picked up her children. She said, "I'll take you all home." And we were all crying because the wind was terrible and it was raining. And it was, North Sea Road was like a river. It was, and we lived on North Sea Road then. And it was very, it was, we were crying and praying. So we finally, she took us home, and we got home. And Mom was relieved that we were okay. And then she took her children home. But it was very scary.
I've heard that from quite a number of people. So, and it sort of came quickly,
mm-hmm.
and then it left, and then
just moved on.
And it
moved on.
But by the next day, it was
beautiful.
Was gone.
Mm-hmm. It was a beautiful day. Mm-hmm.
Did you go out and explore around, or did you stay home? I mean, you said you went to the beach the next day. Pat, what about, do you remember going out?
No, we went to the beach to see what happened. We had heard that two ladies had drowned.
Yeah.
And just everything, there were no dunes, everything was just
the dunes were gone?
Yes.
So, Lake Agawam, down at the bottom of Lake Agawam, what was that like there? Because
We didn't there.
That was where the people drowned, I think, was right around the area of the Dune Church and the that two women had gone down to look at the ocean. Maybe three. Three people down?
Three people. Yes. I just read something about there was a woman in a house, and the wind just took the house off of the platform. The house went floating along out in the street, and the maid was still in the house.
Oh. Was that in Southampton?
That was in Southampton.
Oh, I know we talked to a couple people. I think it was Don Corwin at one point talked about, and he was out in North Sea, mm-hmm. Quite a distance out in North Sea, and said that after the hurricane, he and a friend of his came all the way into Southampton without stepping on the ground, only jumping on trees that had been felled. Wow. It was amazing. We don't have a lot of time left, but let's talk a little bit about World War II days. Can we just talk about where you all were and what your memories are, because I know you were all alive at this point. And Pearl Harbor was attacked. I'm interested in knowing that. Pat, you
well,
want to start?
I just remember our youth group went to Yaphank Poorhouse on December 7, 1941 to have a service. And we went with the Crutchleys. They were our leaders. And when we came
did home, they bring donuts?
I don't remember that. Probably they did. And on the way home, they had the radio on and the news of Pearl Harbor. And we listened to it. And I came home and I told my mother, and I can see her now standing at the foot of the stairs, and the hall was blue. And I remember telling her about what I had heard. And I can remember the expression on her face.
She was so.
To me, I didn't understand how.
Because you were about 12 years old or something, right? Approximately.
Yeah, just about. But that stuck with me. But that was right. My hearing about it. And right. Of course, during the war, I have a poem over there I'll read later.
Oh, yeah. Okay, good. Okay. So what about you, Roxanne? Were you? Do you remember when the war started?
I remember a little bit, but I just know that, you know, we were rationed of,
right.
Of yeah. Certain mm-hmm. things.
Right.
Sugar,
gasoline,
and butter, yeah. and butter, and all those things. We were rationed, and we had to limit ourselves to mm-hmm. how much sugar or butter or whatever was rationed. We had to limit ourselves
okay.
At home. So that we have enough to carry us
okay.
until.
And what about blackout shades?
Oh, yeah.
Do you have that?
Yes.
And then yes. Learning all the planes, we go down at Hick Cooper's,
mm-hmm.
and we go down and check to make sure there were no enemy planes.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember, too, the oil slicks that would wash up
really?
On the beach.
Oh, yes. Yeah.
And of course, from the sunken.
Yes,
I just came back from Hawaii, and we went to Pearl Harbor, and very touching. In fact, they did a presentation and I cried, and there were a lot of Japanese there. They were crying. It was very sad, very touching. And the Arizona, there's oil still seeping out from Arizona, and I thought I saw a bubble. Someone said, "Didn't you see bubbles?" I said, "No, I just saw the oil." You know. But it's very, and we were listening to the radio when that happened, you know, and we were listening to Orphan Annie, or somebody.
Yeah.
And interrupted the show and said, "Special announcement: Pearl Harbor has been attacked." You know, and it was very.
You all were relatively young.
Mm-hmm.
Did you have family friends whose sons went off to the war and then didn't return, or did return?
They were probably all older, but I remember Maria Wobst. My father and I picked her up for orchestra rehearsal. And she got in the car, and she said, "My brother Heinz is missing in action. You know, he was killed.
Right.
He was the most wonderful trumpet player."
Oh, wow.
And then Louise Rainer's brother Lester, I think his name was Lester. He was killed by a sniper.
Mm-hmm.
But
it was all around you, and it was
like.
Yeah, wait, we're going to wait just a minute because our camera time is just about out, so...